So I start here first with presentation of my team. Sorry, next presentation. I have more research assistants, but these two, Christoph and Jan, are working in this field. And I go to the next slide for the, please make it, with the impedance measurement to present it. The question was, why do we need impedance measurement? Okay, I think everybody has some ideas. For me, it's the experience transfer function of lines. We can be modeled even in the frequencies, higher frequencies up to 500 kilohertz. Not good, critical, but more or less. But impedances of connected loads are unknown. And they are very important about it. Without the knowledge of the connected loads of the impedances, you cannot model a grid. And so far, up to now, it's not possible to model it. More critical is that the signal sources of disturbance are unknown. So there is not only the impedances are unknown, especially of disturbance, we are not know the signal sources and how they are characterized. Especially on higher frequency, it was dramatically, and here Mr. Bartak was very active since the last years, because in the frequency range between 30 kilohertz and 150 kilohertz, there was not any limit for voltage distortion. And only with this change, we are measuring it now and we have a limit on it, but not very long. And it's, I don't know if it has already been used for all equipment. But if we have these voltage distortions, it will be only measured in laboratory based on the line impedance simulation network, which is very, very old and does not fit with reality anymore. Real impedances is often much lower, frequency selective and time variant. And so I talk for the complete power line communication community. We observe it since more than 20 years. And the impedances are really going, changing over the time. They're getting more and more frequency selective and more time variant. So there's a grid changed over the time. What results that these measurements are only done in unrealistic environment. So if we do measurements on distortions, voltage distortions, we do it in an unrealistic environment. What is the result? We have no idea of the behavior of equipment under real world conditions now. This behavior is not known and something can happen, stupid things. I think we had a famous report of the University of 20 where smart meters, typically designed for accuracy better than 1%, increased reading up to 366%, so completely stupid values due to effects what happened within the grid. And I think everybody is clear, we need the first a better understanding of the behavior of the grid over full frequency range and also for higher frequencies. Okay, what is our contribution? In this case, I have impedance measurement setup, one of several. This one is a laboratory setup to identify the impedances of components of equipment. In this case, it's a smart meter who is transmitting, also active emitting devices. And in this case, we use this for coexistence problems between or prediction of smart meters. I show it on a point here, what we're doing here. On the left side, we have the device under test. What we want to measure, the impedance. On the right side, we have the device under test. On the left side, we have a connection of the mains. Then we have line filtering and listen to have certified or common reproducible environment. Then we have in the middle our measurement box with a current source and measurement shunts. We are measuring the voltages over the shunts and what we can do. And we generate signals with an USB oscilloscope and picoscope, and we control all of MPC. And we can connect in parallel on line side other devices like communication partners, disturbance, low impedance, or something, what affects the device under test. Okay, what is the concept about it? Simplified, how is our measurement principle? We have again on the right side our impedance, what is selective over the frequency and selective in time. And on the left side, we have a connection to the line with the 50 hertz. Then we need a certain kind of decoupling. Then we have current source onset, and there I'm a little bit to miscellaneous that here is a current source for medium voltage. We have only one for low voltage now and for higher frequencies. So I would nice to have his current source. This is limiting me to now, but okay, with my current source, I measure lower signals on it. And the measurement principle is that we have voltage over time and the voltage over a shunt over time. And based on this, we on the one type make a detection of zero crossing to have the timestamps of the zero crossing. After it, the signal will be high pass filtered because we are looking on impedances on frequencies above 10 kilohertz, in this case above 30 kilohertz, between 30 kilohertz and 500 kilohertz. Then we are mixing to a lower frequency, make a low pass filtering and making complex signals out. It is a classical EQ2 modulator from the communication area. I'm coming from the communication area. The result is we have a classical phasor for one frequency point over the time. So we're measuring time variant phasors for the voltage and for the voltage over the shunt. And if we have these phasors as complex values, we can work with classical formula and calculate out of it the time variant impedance, first for one frequency point after another. And if we do it for several frequency points, we can make a picture about this. And if we synchronize it with the zero crossing, then we can make time variation within a line cycle to show it. And there make a presentation, a measurement result in the laboratory from a very easy device. You see it on the right upper corner. It is a power supply of a tablet, of a Galaxy Tab power supply. And you see there's the impedance over the time. So the impedance here is in the magnitude of the impedance. We have here a dynamic range of a few ohms up to more than 10 kilo ohms. This limitation about 10 kilo ohms, the floor is a noise of our measurements. That is not a limitation, there it is, but our equipment is not able to measure impedances much higher than 10 kilo ohms, and it's also not relevant. And the x-axis, you have a time axis, and this is related to the power cycle. So you see zero crossing is starting with 0 milliseconds and it goes up to 20 milliseconds for one line cycle and is not x point, and the highest voltage about 4 to 6 milliseconds and 14 to 16 milliseconds, we see a low impedance of this device due to the construction of this device. And for me, what is important is to show the impedance is not constant over frequency. It also very strongly variant over the time. So I see a problem if we making this impedances as averaging over one line cycle or several line cycles. What is the impedance of this device averaged over one or several line cycles? So I think we have to handle impedances as they are very time variant and very short on it. And this is our equipment to measure this shortly time variant impedances. And you see, it's not so strongly time variant over the frequency. So what we do now, we make a cut at 200 kilohertz and looking only on the impedance of 200 kilohertz. And we're only looking on the lower impedances. Then you see here second figure. There we have on the top, the magnitude of the impedance. In the middle, the real part of the impedance and down the imaginary part of the impedance. You are seeing this device is coming from a capacitive impedance going to a low inductive impedance and going back over the capacity impedance to high impedance. And it's going down even in this small component. That is not a strong, powerful component, but this component, this small component, are going down to a few ohms, so about 5 ohms for a very short time. And you see here, there's measurements, several measurements over the time. So this process is very constant over the line cycle. If you synchronize it with the line cycle, one measurement lies over another. And that is one to show our possibility of this. Then I change to a second technology of us. This will be presented by Jan.
Yeah, hello everyone. I want to give you now a short introduction into our power quality measurement. As you all know, we have harmonics on our grid voltages, especially here in our laboratory. We measure something that does not anymore look like a sine wave. we have, for example, here of an unloaded voltage outlet, we have this composition. And as you also know, the mains frequency is not constant. So we do mains frequency measurement systems here in our lab. And here you can see a recording over a period of 2 hours. And so it's important now for us, if we talk about harmonics and harmonic composition of signals, they will stay constant in waveform over for different mains frequency values. So we do now talk about the harmonic order, as you all know. This is important because our power quality measurement system concept is taking into account, or is modeled to, let me get a laser pointer, to estimate that this, the grid voltage that we measure is superposition of mains frequency synchronous or harmonic disturbances, which are, for example, caused by nonlinear loads. And we have outside disturbances. This could, for example, be switching or power supply switching frequencies or inverter switching frequencies and something like that. So we have these, where's the mouse? Yeah. I'm so sorry, my PowerPoint just crashed. Okay, give me a second to just restart presentation on that point. So we go back. So now I hope everyone is seeing it again. Great. So we have this mains frequency synchronous effects. And we have these outside disturbances, and we want to perform at first a harmonic analysis and then a non-harmonic analysis. So we want to be able to separate those two effects again that are here taken into account into our model. So we want to re-orthogonalize at first the frequency. We have a mains frequency measurement, and then we, with this mains frequency measurement, we can perform a harmonic analysis. So we can extract everything that is harmonic. So synchronous with the mains frequency. And then we can take this information to subtract all the non-harmonic information that is in our grid, for example, in the voltage or in the currents that we measure. Why do we want to do that? Here is one measurement of ours. It's on an 3.5 kilowatt inverter on our laboratory. And the upper graphic, it's quite normal. This is normal power quality measurement. You should know it. It's the magnitude of the harmonics. But we are now able to very accurately measure the phase of the voltage and current signals and harmonics. For example, we have here, the signal is measured over 1,000 observed periods. It's a approximately 20 seconds measurement. And we can now, independent of the mains frequency that we currently have, measure the phase of this of these voltage harmonics up to very high harmonic order. So way above, for example, the 9 kilohertz, quite accurately. You can see here these bars, you see the standard deviation around the mean value over these 1000 periods that we have observed. And these bars are only plotted if the standard deviation of the phase for this harmonic is below 15 degrees. We can do this also with current measurement. And now it becomes more important because we can now determine power flows on harmonics. So you should be familiar with this graph, with this formula, with this equation, and we can now perform for each harmonic M. So M is our harmonic order. We can perform the apparent, the real power, and the reactive power that are flowing on these harmonics. Okay, that's from me. Thank you very much. And if you have any questions, we are now open to listen to them.
Yes.